since 9/11, where are the Muslim voices? Why are they not speaking out?
The game never changes, only the players. And I see it as the same type of clan tactic that we used to see. It's just they're not using a sheet anymore.
A Muslim cannot be a terrorist.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, we praise Him, we ask His help, we seek His forgiveness. I bear witness that Allah is God and He is God alone. I bear witness that whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal guides, no one can lead that person astray. And whomever Allah, glory be unto Him, allows to go astray, verily there is no guidance for such an individual. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal sends His blessing upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I pray that Allah sends His blessings upon the family of the Prophet Muhammad and the righteously guided servants, the righteously guided companions of that man. I bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad was Khatam al-Nabiyyin. He was the seal of the prophets. He was Sadiqul Masduq. He was the one to be listened to. He was the one to be trusted. Allah, glory be unto Him, says in His book, the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, may yartadda minkum ad-dini fasawfa yatillahu biqulmin yuhibuhum wa yuhibuna adhillatin ala al-mukhminin a'izzatin ala al-kafirin. O you who believe. And I find it interesting in the Quran, you find this statement so many times. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, calling those who believe. O you who believe, the Quran says in Surah 5, Ayah 54, if any of you turn back from this religion of Islam, Allah will replace you with another people. They will love Him and He will love them. The Quran says they will be gentle with the believers and they will be firm with the non-believers. MashaAllah. So it is a prophecy in the Quran that people would be munafiq, that people would become murtad, they would apostate, they would be hypocrites. This is a prophecy that you find in the Quran itself. Now, there's a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the hadith says, in English, the translation, hasten to do good works before calamity strikes, like a dark night. A person will go to bed, a believer. Well, actually it says a person will wake up in the morning, a believer, and they will go to bed, a disbeliever. And vice versa, a person will go to bed believing in Islam, the Prophet Muhammad said, and they will wake up in the morning, a non-believer, and they would sell their religion for the frail goods of this world. Now you have people like Irshad Manji, you have people like Salman Rushdie, you have people like Noni Darwish. You have all of these people from all of these places in the world, from the Muslim world. I'm not talking about the non-Muslims. I'm talking about from the Muslim world. People with Muslim mothers, Muslim fathers, many raised in Muslim lands, coming out and speaking out against Islam and speaking up for a system of kufr. Now, I'm not here to pass judgment on America or Britain or any other country in the West. I'm not here even to pass judgment on the Muslim countries or the socialist countries or the communist countries. I'm not telling nobody to do anything foolish. The most powerful weapon that the Muslim has is dua. Dua is the weapon of the believer. Prayer is the weapon of the believer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never, ever, and Allahu a'lam. But from my understanding of the religion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to help a people. He's not going to be on their side unless those people are on his side. And the Muslim countries today have been colonized. They've been oppressed. This is history I'm talking about, that Westerners have written with their own hands. And many Muslims, in order to play along, to get along, they switched from Islam to other philosophies in order to gain the dunya, in order to gain some woman, let's face it, Salman Rushdie, how else? They do it for secular reasons, to gain the frail goods of this world. And I would like to thank all of the Muslims who are doing this for making me stronger in my deen. Because when you say things, when you say these things, I'm not the type of person who just overlooks them. When you say these things, I'm the type of person who researches. This is how I ended up leaving Christianity, because the more I researched it, the more nonsensical it became. But Islam, the more I research it, the more it makes sense. And I have been a Muslim for 20 years. And I say, Alhamdulillah ala kullu shay. Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. Not just because Allah has blessed the Muslims with a high birth rate, but because you can see people in the UK where the number one name for baby boys born there is Muhammad. In the UK, according to the BBC, you have many young Caucasian women saying La ilaha illallah. You can go down to Mexico and see people who are Mexican taking Shahada. You can go anywhere in the world and you can find people converting to Islam, which is understandable. Irshad Manji says this about Islam.
And the continuing scourge of slavery in regions that are ruled by Islam.
Black Muslims, and not just Christians in Darfur, would be enslaved and raped and slaughtered, all with the express support of a government that calls itself Islamic.
Now, slavery is a topic that is a video by itself. I could stay here and talk to you for 3 hours about slavery and tell you some of my first-hand experience, not of being a slave, but being a descendant of slaves raised in America. I'm not going to do that. But I will say, what is going on in any country, I would not single out the Muslim countries, because from my research, the largest slave route in the world is in Southeast Asia. And it's the sex slave trade in Southeast Asia. When you talk about the Philippines, when you talk about Thailand, especially Bangkok, Singapore, you know, I know Singapore is not in Bangkok, it's a country of its own, but they have a large sex slave trade there. Irshad Manji would never talk about that, because oppression is not what she hates. That's not on the agenda. She can tell you everything bad you want to know, every lie you need to hear about Islam, and she can do it all for $19.99. That's how much her deen is worth to her. She says she doesn't know if she'll go to heaven.
I don't think that, I will necessarily go to heaven. I don't think that, I will necessarily go to heaven.
I say I agree with her. I agree. And even though she claims to be Muslim, let me make it clear. I'm not here to make takfir. I'm not here to say who's Muslim and who's not. That is not my responsibility. I will say if she believes what she is saying, she is a kafir. Maybe she doesn't believe it. Maybe she's under duress. If that's true, I make dua for her. I pray for her. That whoever is forcing her to say this, or whatever pressure is upon her, that makes her utter these atrocities against Islam, these utter lies against Islam, I pray that is lifted from her. But if she believes what she is saying, she is a kafir. And I advise her to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal. Especially being that Irshad Manji is of Indian descent. And when slavery was abolished in 1808, the coolies of India were treated worse than the blacks of Africa by the British Empire. If you look at what the British, and this is history I'm talking about, that the British have written with their own hand, you can look up, I think it's called the Amritsar Massacre, which happened in 1919, April the 13th, where British soldiers shot and killed hundreds of unarmed Indian civilians. They wounded thousands of people, mostly women and children, because they had the audacity to protest against the British government. Irshad Manji won't tell you that. But she'll accuse Muslims of slavery, and there are Muslims involved in slavery. There are Muslims who drink. There are Muslims who do all types of acts that are against the teachings of Islam. But just like you do not blame a car for a bad driver, you do not blame the religion of Islam for people who are not adhering to its principles. So you say the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a slave master. You say the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam owned slaves. You say the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, traded slaves. I say you're right. But I will say the truth. The Prophet Muhammad freed more than 1,000 slaves. The Prophet Muhammad came into a land where slavery already existed, and he made rules not to eradicate slavery, because slavery cannot be eradicated. If you're going to eradicate slavery, you better eradicate the present system in each and every country in the world today, because when you take a person's freedom, that person is a slave. The American Constitution, the 13th Amendment, says that slavery shall not exist within the confines of the United States or its provinces except as punishment for a crime. And then they play with the law so it targets blacks, and they come up with black codes with pig laws. Even North Carolina versus Maine, where a person borrowed a slave, killed her, and the state said it was okay because she was not considered a human being. You could kill a slave in America and there was nothing wrong with it. You could rape a slave in America and there was nothing wrong with it. This is not what happened in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the United States Constitution, until this day, non-Europeans, blacks and Native Americans, even Chinese, are counted as 3/5 of a human being. Compare that to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said the slaves are your brothers. They have to wear the same thing you wear. They have to eat the same food you eat. If you marry a slave girl, she gives birth to a child of yours, that child is free. That child is not called a mulatto. That child is not called a quadroon or octoroon. That child is called free. That's what that child is called. And the slave girl, from my readings, is also free. The Prophet Muhammad dealt with something that was handed to him. He was not like George Washington. George Washington was born into a land where the people had eradicated the nation, the Native Americans. They tried to wipe them out. A land where people were kidnapped. People were kidnapped from Africa and forced to endure a middle passage where millions upon millions upon millions of them died. When you cross the Atlantic Ocean, when you fly across the Atlantic Ocean, you're flying across or you're sailing across millions of bodies of dead Africans who chose the ocean to democracy. Millions of Africans who chose the bottom of the sea to the shores of America because they knew of the cruelty in that land. This never happened in Al-Islam. In the religion of Islam, even in the Arab world, and may I remind you, the Arabs only make up 18%. Arabs only make up 18% of the Muslim population. Every Muslim is not Arab and every Arab is not Muslim. So when Irshad Manji talks about Islam and slavery, she's mainly talking about Arab culture. Islam is not an extension of Arab culture, or else Arabs would not have been the first people to fight against Islam. It wasn't the Americans, it wasn't the Yahudi, it was the Arab. So you cannot identify the actions of every Arab with the protocols of Islam any more than you can identify one black drug dealer as the standard for the black race. And that's what they used to do. You know, they say all blacks are drug dealers. You know, they're rapists. Just like now they say all Muslims, they're terrorists. They're suicide bombers. Because once they brand you as an evil human being that needs to be eliminated, it's easy for them to exterminate you, drop daisy cutters on your children, and rape your wives in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and all over the world. It's an old trick. It's nothing new. It's nothing new. I want to say this, and I'm finished. I'm finished. I'm not going to be long. Now, there's a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I just want to touch on briefly, if I may. It's the famous raisin head hadith. The non-believers and the enemies of Islam like to say that the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, he said, obey your leader, even if he is Abdun Habashi, a slave with a head like a raisin, an African slave. Habashi is Ethiopia now. Even if he's an Ethiopian slave with a head like a raisin. And do you know, they come out and they say this is racist. The hadith says, if the slave calls you by the book of Allah, by the way, I forgot that part. If the slave calls you by the book of Allah, obey him, even if he has a head like a raisin. They say that's racist. He called blacks raisin heads, even though it was talking about a hypothetical. It was not talking about an actual. There's another hadith that's hypothetical, where the Prophet Muhammad said, in Arabic means if, like inshallah, if it's the will of Allah. In umru alaykum abdun mujadda'un yaqadukum bi kitab Allah fa'asma'u lahu wa'ati'u. Obey your leader, even if it is a slave with cut off limbs, if he calls you by the book of Allah. What's the point? Racism against Africans? The point is, appearance does not matter. If your leader is calling you by the book of Allah, by Al-Kitab, follow that leader. Listen to that leader. It makes no difference. That is the point. Don't call the Prophet Muhammad a slave master unless you know what happened there. If you don't know what happened, if you don't know the history, if you haven't read the seerah, you need to shut your mouth. You need to shut your mouth. Point blank, period. The Prophet Muhammad forbade the type of slavery that the people in America implemented, that they inflicted upon the African American. It was a horrendous thing that not only didn't exist in Islam, it never existed in any religion except Europeanized Christianity. That's the only place it ever existed. Christianity as practiced by the Europeans. And may I remind you that the Byzantine Empire, who were Christians, had invaded North Africa before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was even born. There's a man who says that most people think that the weight of slavery lies squarely on the shoulders of the Christian European, and he says it's not true, and he tries to blame the Arabs, but he forgot about the Byzantine army, who were Christian Europeans who had already invaded Africa long before the Prophet Muhammad was born, and they were driven out by the Vandals, who were also Christian Europeans, the Vandal tribe. That's right, they inflicted so much torture, so much destruction upon Africa, until this day, anytime something is violently and viciously destroyed for no reason, they call it vandalism after these Christian Europeans. They don't call that Mohammedism, they call that vandalism, because of what those Christian Europeans did to Africa. Wallahi azim. Islam is not defined by the mouth of Salman Rushdie.
I come from an aspect of Muslim culture in which every single woman in my family fought against the idea of the veil. And as I say, the world is full of believing Muslim women who have spent their lives fighting against this.
Islam is not defined by the words of Irshad Manji.
Veiling yourself is often sort of confused by Muslim women as an act of spiritual submission. I'm arguing it's more like cultural capitulation.
Now, this is not in correlation with the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal says in his book, talking to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhan nabiyu, O Prophet, kuli azwajik, tell your wives, wa banatik, and your daughters. And this is the kicker. Listen to me well. Listen to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa nisa il mu'minin, and believing women. Yadnina allahinna min jalabibihin, to pull their jilbabs over their bosoms. Dhalaka adna ayu arafna, that's better for them. It's the maruf. So, and this is my observation, I've had people disagree with me. If you're against the hijab, you cannot call yourself a believing woman, and you are diametrically opposed to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you in the Quran. Islam is defined by the Quran, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal. Islam is defined by the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. Islam is not defined by anything else except those two things, the Quran and the Sunnah. That's what it's defined by. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not say that you are a believing woman, but you don't have to wear hijab. It doesn't say that. But even if a woman walks down the street buck ball naked, there is no reason for any man to accost her. And even if a woman wants to wear her hijab, there's no reason for any man to pull it off. There's no reason for any man to molest her any more than it would molest a nun or any other woman for their religious belief. There's no excuse. There's no excuse. When you see a nun walking down the street, you don't say, oh, there goes an oppressed woman, the priest must be making her wear that. You said, there goes a dedicated woman. And the women in hijab who are doing it for the sake of Allah, may Allah bless them and strengthen them, especially the ones who are living outside of Muslim countries where we know things are difficult.
The Prophet of Islam married his second wife when she was 6. He was over 50. I always remember my
wife is Sultan. I shouldn't even mess with wife assaulter. She's an obvious liar. She's a liar. I don't have to say anything. Listen to her own words.
At the age of 25, my niece committed suicide by setting herself on fire. She was burned to death. My niece committed suicide at the age of 27 by setting herself on fire.
At the age of 28, my niece committed suicide, leaving four children behind her.
Wafa Sultan accused the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam of being a pedophile, and he accused the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam of molesting Aisha radiallahu anha. Now Aisha, when she married the Prophet Muhammad at 6 years old, and she was 6 years old, according to her, if you say she was 18, if you say she was 20, 21, you're calling Aisha a liar, because the hadith of Aisha is sahih. It's authentic. Nobody disputes it's authentic. So are you saying that Aisha was a liar? These people today who are coming out criticizing the marriage of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to his wife Aisha, if Aisha was here today, she would be the first person to criticize these people. Aisha would have no part of that. Aisha collected more hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam than any other sahabi except Abu Huraira. And she said about the Prophet Muhammad, "Kana kulluku nabi Allah Quran," that the very nature of that man was the Quran. She didn't say he was a child molester. She didn't say he was a hypocrite. She said the very nature of that man is the Quran. And the people of that time, the pre-Islamic Arabs, who had basically the same beliefs as Wafa Sultan, they had basically the same beliefs as Wafa Sultan, and they called the Prophet Muhammad crazy. They called the Prophet Muhammad a soothsayer. They called the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a fortune teller. They called him all types of things, but one thing they didn't say he was a child molester, because his marriage was something that was socially accepted at that time. Yet and still, people will come and say, "But your prophet was supposed to be a prophet for all times. Why did he submit to the standards of our 6th century Arabia? Why did he do that?" He didn't. The Prophet Muhammad made marriage dependent on the maturity of the woman's body. That doesn't change. Now you can go and do some research on a Christian girl named Lena Medina, who gave birth to her child when she was 5 years old. 5 years old. Somebody told me this once, and I apologize to that brother if he's still listening, because I thought he was crazy. I said, "Brother, you can't repeat this." I looked it up. He's right. 5 years old. I personally know a girl who gave birth to a child when she was 10. Who was the father? She was molested by her mother's boyfriend. Most of these cases where these young children give birth, there's molestation in there. And then the person who the child is fathered by doesn't claim the child, and they leave that child with a sense of inferiority for the rest of their life. Unsure who their father is, or knowing who their father is, and knowing that their father was just some man who molested their mother. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not like that. He wasn't like that. Aisha radiallahu anha, if she was alive today, and if she was in America, she could go to some states, and she could not get married to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam until she was 13. Now in another state, the age of consent is 15. You go to another state and the age of consent might be 21. You go to another state and the age of consent will differ in every state in the United States. Now you go overseas to Europe, You go to the different countries in Europe and the different provinces within the countries, and you'll see the age of consent will vary. So do you expect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make a different age of consent to comply with every country, in every province, in every state, everywhere in the world today? No. He was a prophet for all time. And what doesn't change is the woman's age of sexual maturity. When the body says the woman is sexually mature, this is when she is ready for marriage. I'm not saying for people who are in a non-Muslim country to go out and marry a five-year-old. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had wives of different ages. It is not mandatory for a man to marry a six-year-old. Most Muslims, they don't do it. But it is an option. It is an option if you're in a Muslim country that has Sharia law, and to my knowledge right now, there are none. Now, Salman Rushdie also says this.
You know, in the way the Taliban banned music, you know, I mean, there's an American humorist who once said that Puritanism is, get this right, is the haunting fear that someone somewhere might be happy.
Now, music and happiness don't go hand in hand. And as a person who grew up in a culture that is one of the most musical cultures in the world, the African American community, I can't think of any culture that's more musical. Music does not make you happy. If music makes you happy, why do you have so many people overdosing to iTunes? If music makes you happy, why wasn't Whitney Houston happy? Why couldn't Michael Jackson sleep? Elvis Presley didn't seem happy to me. What about Amy Winehouse? Why wasn't she happy? Dead at 29 years old. But you associate happiness with music? Islam would have saved Amy Winehouse, and Allahu A'lam. Islam would have saved, it would have saved Whitney Houston. Islam would have saved Michael. In Islam, drugs are haram, but her record company, Amy Winehouse, Whitney Houston, their record companies would rather see them in a grave than in hijab. Because if they wear hijab, then that hurts their sexy image, okay? It hurts the record sales. They don't want that. But a dead legend is worth money. So the grave is a place where you go when you can't sell records no more. It's not happiness. Irshad Manji also says this.
But before I can be convinced that, you know, being in a same-sex relationship is inherently sinful, I have questions of my own for my detractors. They ask me to reconcile Islam and homosexuality. Let me ask them, how do you reconcile the fact that the Quran is very clear that God deliberately designed the world's breathtaking multiplicity, and that everything he created is, quote, excellent, and nothing he has created is in vain? How do you reconcile those statements with your total condemnation of homosexuality?
Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal, he created everything. He created test in this life, in this world, for us. Because people have to be tested. The Quran said, did you think you would not be tested when those before you were tested? A person's natural sexual desires are a test. And those who have desires more perverted than others, like luti people, homosexuals, their desires are more perverse. These people are in greater need of Islam, wallahi. they're in greater need of Islam. Don't bring the homosexuality to the deen. Leave the homosexuality behind. It's killing you. And come to Islam. You were not born that way. I don't care what Gaga says. You were not born that way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal created man in aqsani taqweem, the best of molds. And then we make decisions that either bring us closer to Allah or closer to the hellfire. Don't tell me about a gay gene. Dean Hamer's research never pinpointed any gay gene. This is a hypothetical. Dean Hamer used only homosexuals in his study. People who had a precondition, you know, it's like getting a bunch of cancer patients together and finding the same gene in all of these people, or finding the same similarities in all of these people who you already know have cancer. That's what Dean Hamer did. But he never pinpointed any exact gene. So you cannot say scientifically that homosexuals are born that way. And even if they were, which they weren't, they were not, a man is still a man. A man whose beard won't grow is still a man. A man who has low testosterone is still a man. You can't say he's not a man. You can't say that these homosexuals are not men. That's the way they were born. And if they were a defect of nature, and for you Darwinists out there, okay, if homosexuality was a condition, if they're born that way, it's a birth defect. It's a birth defect. Because homosexuals cannot produce under natural methods. Okay? You can have a man and a woman, sometimes they're old and they think they're infertile, and all of a sudden the woman gets pregnant. That's never happened with a homosexual. You've never seen two men together and all of a sudden one of the men get pregnant. It's an impossibility. It's an impossibility. This is nothing personal against anybody who may be afflicted with this trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal, because everybody has their own personal trials, their own personal afflictions. Allah put that before us, not that we should submit to our desires, but that we should overcome them. Now we have another person who's going to be controversial. Louis Farrakhan.
When I met the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I met my father. He fathered me into knowledge, into wisdom, into understanding.
Louis Farrakhan, in 1975, when Elijah Poole died, Elijah Muhammad, and his son Warthadeen Muhammad took over. And I'm not going to sit here and criticize Warthadeen Muhammad, even though I don't agree with many of the things he said. He made mistakes. He was a human being. If I'm not going to criticize the King of Jordan or King Nasser of Egypt and Hosni Mubarak, formerly of Egypt, and Ataturk and all of these Muslim leaders past and present, who Warthadeen Muhammad siphoned his philosophy from, I'm not going to sit here and criticize Warthadeen Muhammad. I don't have time for that, even though I don't agree with many of the things he said. But he was a Muslim, and he did a good thing by dismantling the Nation of Islam. He did a very, very good thing. And Louis Farrakhan pledged allegiance, gave bay'ah to Warthadeen Muhammad. But when Warthadeen Muhammad started assimilating his community with the people who were practicing Islam as understood by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that's when Louis Farrakhan totally rebelled, broke off, and restarted the Nation of Islam with the misnotion of Islam taught by Elijah Muhammad. Astaghfirullah Azim. Like I said, I'm not making takfir. Louis Farrakhan, if he's being forced to say what he's saying, if somebody's like threatening to kill him, and these people believe in what they believe so much that will kill you. If Louis Farrakhan started teaching the Sunnah and he didn't do it right, they would take his head off. They would take his head off in a heartbeat. The only people they've ever killed have been black people. They have never lifted a finger against anyone who wasn't black. They're very good at killing their own. If Louis Farrakhan has a fear for his life, for his family, for his children, for his grandbabies, I understand that. But I cannot, as a Muslim, say what they are teaching is Islam. I cannot say that he is a Muslim if he believes the things he is saying because they are not the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Islam has done great things for black people in America. Islam, not the Nation of Islam, not Elijah Muhammad's teachings, have done great things for black people. It's taking them off drugs, stopping them from illicit relationships. I hope if you're a black person looking at this and you're a Muslim, I hope you don't have a girlfriend. I hope you have a wife. Hope you have a good wife. If you're a black person looking at this who is a Muslim, I hope you're not getting high, because Islam takes people away from that. And if you're not black, if you're from another country, somebody who's come to America or any country in the West, I hope you came there to spread Islam. I hope you didn't come to the ghetto to spread evil. You know, the Prophet Muhammad said, Man ra'a minkum munkar falyughayyir biyadihi fa in lam yastata fa bilisani fa in lam yastata fa biqalbihi wa dhalika adaful iman wa dhalika adaful iman. He said, if you see an evil, you should change it with your hands. If you can't change it with your hands, you should change it with your speech. If you can't change it with your speech, you should hate it in your heart. And that's where change begins. But if you come to these communities and call yourself a Muslim, and you're selling pork, you're selling alcohol, you're selling lottery tickets, if you're a black man, born and raised in America, and you call yourself a Muslim, and you're selling dope, you don't even hate it in your heart. How can you hate it when you're selling it? How can you hate evil when you're a proprietor of it? You can't say you hate it. You can't say you hate it. If you see an evil, you should change it with your hands, your speech, or you should hate it in your heart. And hating it in your heart is the weakest of faith. So if you don't hate it and you're out there selling it, you don't hate it. So you can't say you have any faith. Louis Farrakhan's people are out there trying to clean people up, straighten them up, but yet and still, that's not Islam. That's not Islam. Islam is based on the belief. And when you say that the Prophet Muhammad was a liar, and that's what Elijah Muhammad taught. He taught that the Prophet Muhammad was a liar. Elijah Poole said that the black man is God. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who's given the Quran, and in that book, it says clearly about Allah that no vision can encompass him. لا تدركه الأبصار لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك Abbasan. No vision can encompass him, but he encompasses all vision. Everybody could clearly see W.D. Farad was white. Everybody saw it. If he was Allah, nobody would have seen he was white, because Allah can't be seen. But you could look at Master Farad Muhammad, the white man they call Master, and see the hypocrisy and the illogical nature of their belief. Saying that a man who can be seen is Allah, when the Quran says that Allah cannot be seen, and saying that a white man is God, and at the same time saying the white man is the devil. It's illogical. Doesn't make sense. It just doesn't gel. Another thing the Prophet Muhammad said that Elijah Poole called a lie, because Elijah Poole said that when you die, you go in the grave and that's it. So you better get yours here on earth, because heaven and hell are on this earth. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this about the earth. He said, "Law kanat ad-dunya ta'dilu inda laha janaha ba'udatin ma saqa kafran min hasharbatin ma'in." If this entire world was as valuable to Allah as the wing of a mosquito, then Allah would not give a non-believer a drink of water. If this entire earth was as valuable to Allah as the wing of a mosquito, then Allah would not give a non-believer a drink of water. Elijah Muhammad was a liar. Farrakhan is an apostate, because he left the teachings of Islam that were beginning to be taught by Warthadeen Muhammad, may Allah read his heart, and he went back and started teaching the evil of Elijah Muhammad. Anything that I said that was wrong, astaghfirullah azim, I ask the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal. Anything that I said that was right, I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glory be unto him. I pray that Allah blesses the Muslims to hold fast with istiqamah in this religion of al-Islam. I pray that all of those who have gone astray find their way back to the siratul mustaqim, the straight path. I pray that every Muslim who may be listening to this, every Muslim that may be having a problem with alcohol, a Muslim that may be having a problem with drugs, a Muslim that may be having a problem with their aqidah, a Muslim who may be having a problem with their iman, I want you to know that there is no religion better than the religion of Islam. Islam is a religion that takes people out of the gutters and puts them on pedestals of pearls and gold. That's how valuable this religion is. And if you don't understand that, you need to open your Quran, open the books of Hadith, and study this religion yourself. Get some tafsir. Ibn Kathir is the best. Ibn Abbas, that's good. Get some Hadith. And I pray that Allah opens your eyes and opens your heart and guides us all. And may we all unite in Jannah. To the Muslims, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. To the non-Muslims, I leave you in peace.